activities and received Dr. S. Radhakrishnan Memorial National Teacher Award, received Distinguished Service Award from Delhi Medical Association, received Excellence in Medical Service Award from Delhi Gynec Forum, Ati Vishisht Chikitsa Ratna Award from Medical Association, Indian Medical Association, conducted and participated in many workshops and conferences at national and international level, special interest in endoscopy surgeries and cosmetic gynec surgery. Thank you all, ma'am, and it is in fact an honor for me to introduce the three distinguished speakers for today. And I request an honor. Ashim, ma'am, you have logged in from mobile?
Yes.
So for the Shield Connect launch, then I request Vandana, ma'am.
Yeah.
To play an AV, ma'am, we'll do a AV play first, and then we'll provide you a link from a remote. So from your mouse, you can launch that Web Connect. Okay. Chitrakala, can I have the AV, please? Ma'am, you can now click on the link. Rights are given to you. Shield Connect.
You can give it to me also.
From mobile, it may not happen.
No. I have to share the screen, no?
It's connecting now.
Okay.
It's not opening.
It's not opening.
It will take a little minute, ma'am.
Yeah. There it is. Yeah.
This is our digital platform, ma'am, which we have created. It is definitely to connect all of you doctors. So where, your presentations, your papers, your lectures can be posted here and your juniors can see and learn. And a place where all the doctors can see, and an academic interest is taken care here. And in terms of any papers which we have come across, so we would be presenting here so that it can be as a library for you, all of you to read through and utilize this platform. It is endorsed by several of your colleagues indeed. So we are happy to have all of you here, Dr. Shama ma'am and Dr. Ashish. Thank you, ma'am. It was a pleasure to have, you know, this Shield Connect launched by all three of you. Over to the first speaker, ma'am, Dr. Shamam Batra.
Can you see the slides?
Yes. Make it full screen.
Yeah. Is it full screen now?
No.
One second.
You have to make it a little full screen, Shama.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bottommost. Yeah. Yeah.
No, it's fine.
No, not as yet. You didn't click on it.
Yeah, I've done. Okay, it's coming.
No, iske bara. Ha. Click on it.
I clicked.
No, you didn't click. You just visited it. Yeah. Click on it.
Yeah, I can see full.
You can, ma'am, you can hold shift and F5, function 5. Hold shift and function 5. It will take you to the full screen.
Shift
and function 5, F5. There are F1, F2, F3, F5 in there.
Yeah. Again, I'll share after. Let me stop and see. Then they can have the one with.
Main, but I think.
You'll have to make it full screen. Click on this bottom one.
Yeah,
now it's okay.
We can scroll up, you'll get the first one. Thank you.
We're changing it.
Click on the slide and then it'll change. Click on the slide first. Bring your cursor on the slide.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll change now.
No, it's.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks. First of all, I thank Dr. Ashe and Dr. Vanna for your kind words and Mr. Prashad. Today's topic is very important. We are talking on adolescent PCOS and insulin resistance. What's the definition of adolescence? That we know from Latin, adolescere, meaning to grow up, transitional change of stage of physical and psychological development from puberty to adulthood. Adolescent are those people which is age between 10 to 19 years. Females age between 10 to 19 years. Adolescent PCOS, unexplained persistent hyperandrogenic unovulation. This is the stage when we say that there is an adolescent PCOS. Like unexplained persistent hyperandrogenic unovulation. What are the risk factors? First is premature puberty, that is before 8 years old, and obesity, if there is any family history, and ethnicity, more common we are seeing in African and American. What's the prevalence of adolescent PCOS? It's nearly 2.2% to 18%, depending on the diagnostic criteria, and again, ethnicity, increasing prevalence of childhood obesity, and improvement in diagnosis. What's the incidence of adolescent PCOS? If we use strictly NIH criteria, it's nearly 6% to 8%, and according to Rotterdam criteria, 15% to 25%. In Indian Asian urban community, this number is more, and it seems to be rising for reason unknown. Because of the lifestyle, I think. The PCOS diagnostic criteria. NIH 1990, there's a criteria, menstrual irregularity, hyperandrogenism, and exclusion of other etiology. But in Rotterdam 2003, out of at least two criteria should be there, like menstrual irregularity, either hyperandrogenism, and ultrasound polycystic ovary, and exclusion of other etiology. All three should be there at least in the Rotterdam 2033. And AES 2006, menstrual irregularity, and ultrasound, you can diagnose polycystic ovary, and hyperandrogenism and exclusion of other etiologies. Now you can see polycystic ovary and menstrual dysfunction, hyperandrogenism, the whole thing, three things goes to PCO, polycystic ovarian syndrome. What will be the prevalence? How PCOs affect? PCO affect 1 in 10 women. Nearly 10% of women of childbearing age estimated to have polycystic ovarian syndrome. 50% of the patients are undiagnosed. We are not knowing they have PCOs or not. 50% of the women with PCOs who will develop nearly type 2 diabetes or predisposing before age 40. And sometimes 4.3 billion estimated annual cost to the American healthcare system to diagnose women with PCOs. And these increase risk of women with PCO developing endometrial carcinoma. If we are not diagnosing PCOs, it can lead to in future endometrial carcinoma. What are the risk factors of progressive course? Persistent irregular cycles 6 years after menarche, then persistent unovulatory cycle 3 years after menarche, and there will be increased basal metabolic BMI. What is the pathogenesis behind PCOD? Insulin resistance, there is a change in GnRH pulsatility, genetic, and low birth weight and early puberty. What the patient comes with, which presentation patient comes with, like menstrual irregularity, chronic anovulation, hyperandrogenism, sometimes patient comes with the acne, hirsutism, there is androgenic alopecia, then hyperandrogenemia, then PCOs, we have on diagnosed PCO on ultrasound. Then where is the dilemma comes? Over diagnosis, either we are diagnosing over or under diagnosis of PCOs. Diagnosis. Normal puberty changes resembles PCOs. Sometimes if there is no PCO, we have patient comes with menstrual irregularity, then hyperandrogenism and insulin resistance. Specific and very strict criteria should be fulfilled. What are the symptoms and their frequency in PCOs in adolescent? Nearly 70% of the patient comes with the menstrual cycle disturbance. In this, it could be oligomenorrhea 50%, amenorrhea 10%, abnormal heavy bleeding 10 to 15%, and the patient comes with hyperandrogenism, nearly 70% of the cases, acne 70%, hirsutism 70%, alopecia can be seen nearly 10%. But dermatologists feel alopecia is not at all uncommon, around 20%. Then acanthosis nigricans, nearly 1 to 3% we have seen in the lean PCOs and 20% we have seen in obese PCOs. And obesity 50 to 60%. Normal menstruation, patient has a normal menstruation, but we can diagnose a PCOs with other criteria, like with the ultrasound, hyperandrogenism, something like. So 20% patient has normal menstruation. And sometimes patient comes with infertility. What is the irregular menstrual cycle? What is the pattern of the irregular menstrual cycle in adolescent PCOs? Definition of irregular menstrual cycle in adolescent according to time or postmenarche. If the less than 1 year postmenarche, irregular menstrual cycle or normal pubertal transition. If it is more than 1 year, less than 1 year, and the time period of the menses will be less than 21 and more than 45 days. If it is more than 3 year postmenarche, and it is between 20, less than 21 and more than 35 days, and 8 cycles per year, less than 8 cycles per year. Or if it is more than 1 year postmenarche, and 1 cycle more than it coming 90 days. After 90 days, if you are receiving the cycle, then it also come, it has come under the pattern irregular menstrual cycle. And in the, some of the cases like primary amenorrhea by age 15 years or more than 3 years after post-telarche, that is breast development. And some of the cycles are unovulatory cycles, nearly 1 year after menarche, 85% anovulatory. Then after 3 years, if it is 59%, and 6 years if it is 25%. What is the prevalence of polycystic ovary in adolescence? We can see prevalence of polycystic ovaries increased throughout the puberty, 6 years at 6 year old, and 26% by 15 year old girl. What are the physiological changes in adolescence? You can see hyperinsulinemia and insulin resistance, then hyperpulsivity of the gonadotropin secretion. There will be an ovarian androgen synthesis will be hyperactive, and adrenal androgen synthesis will be hyperactive, and there will be menstrual irregularity. There will be decreased level of IGF and sex hormones binding globulin. And there will be increased insulin level. In some patient, you can see increased insulin levels, and then IGF activity increases, androgen during puberty, probably as including factors in development of PCOS. After puberty, sometime insulin and IGF, these factors, they progressively decrease in the most females, those who doesn't have PCOS. Then there is a Karamina 2010. What it says requires the presence of all three criteria, like hyperandrogenism, like biochemical or progressive hirsutism, then ovulatory dysfunction persisting beyond 2 years postmenarche. Then third is the polycystic ovarian morphology, that is ovarian volume is more than 10 ml. What all clinical manifestation you can see? Acne, then acanthosis nigrans, then you can see the hirsutism and obesity, then irregular menses and hair loss and infertility in further life. Androgen Access Society, what it says? It says in 2006, one is chronic anovulation and oligomenorrhea less than 6 cycles per year. If your cycle is less than 6 cycles per year, then patient has to come and show us, then we can diagnose further what all are the causes behind. If there is for 2 years, 6 menarche or primary amenorrhea at the age of 17 years. Second one is hyperandrogenism. Acne or hirsutism is not the criteria for the diagnosis. Acne unresponsive to the topical treatment. If you are giving treatment and it is not getting relief, then get the test for hyperandrogenemia. Then progressive hirsutism. Then important sign of adolescent PCOS, that's a very important point. Then we have to look after where the patient is getting more and more hairs. Then third is hyperandrogenemia, most consistent marker, extremely important. It is no established normal ranges. Nearly FT level is more than 1.3 and TT level is more than 1. This is the Rotterdam Consensus Workshop Group. And what is the cutoff? Adult cutoff should be used until appropriate pubertal levels are defined, according to the Endocrine Society Clinical Practice 2013. This is very important. Most of the patient comes with this ultrasound. Then we have to diagnose further. Is it PCOD or not? Sometimes there is an increased ovarian volume will be there and more than nearly 10 centimeters. And in ultrasound criteria of polycystic ovarian morphology, presence of 12 or more follicles in each ovary, diameter will be more or volume will be more than 10 ml. No subjective assessment. You have to omit the stromal echogenicity and the volume. I think I have told you about what are the signs and symptoms, what are the causes. And now there's the next is what is the metabolic. What is the metabolic reason behind PCOS? So I request my another speaker, Dr. Vanna, to talk about the insulin resistant part of the PCOS and tell about the treatment part also.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma. Yeah. Thank you for the nice deliberations. Thank you for setting up so nicely the causes and the pathogenesis. Now, PCOS comes attached with metabolic syndrome. Now we know that insulin metabolism is basic to PCOS presentation. Maybe hyperinsulinemia is the base cause, which is driving force of hyperandrogenemia as well. Both of them support each other. Thus, we get a presentation of metabolic syndrome in approximately 43 to 46% of the women. It is common, though not universally found in PCOS, with a prevalence estimated to be 50 to 70% of the cases. Next. So adiponectin, which is another hormone secreted by adipocytes, it regulates the lipid metabolism and glucose levels. Both lean and obese women with PCOS have lower adiponectin levels than women without PCOS, thus leading to obesity. Of obese women with PCOS, 10% will have undiagnosed diabetes and 35% will have impaired glucose tolerance. That's a heavy burden. Next. So lipid profiles definitely will go haywire. Almost 70% of the patients with PCOS have an abnormal lipid profile with high TGs and high-low density lipoproteins. That cholesterol is often found. Next. So this is the basic thing. You come with a genetic bias and then your lifestyle increases the chances of you developing PCOS. The genetic bias may be causing your increase in androgen and causing hirsutism and acne. And hormonal changes, these are augmented by an abnormal lifestyle, like you being a couch potato, you keep on gaining weight. The adolescents are stuck to the TV screen and they are not exercising enough. So obesity exacerbates the hormonal changes. This leads to hyperinsulinemia. Obesity per se can cause hyperinsulinemia. And if it is associated with hormonal abnormalities, it gets attached to PCOS. And hyperinsulinemia and hyperandrogenemia are interrelated. They all lead to disbalanced ovarian follicular genesis. So we have anovulation and increased estrogen. Insulin increase resistance would cause diabetes mellitus and metabolic syndrome. Poor folliculogenesis would lead to menstrual disturbances and subfertility. Hyperandrogenemia leads to hirsutism and acne. And this metabolic syndrome will lead to increased cardiovascular risk, which has been seen to be related to mean platelet volume. So you need to keep an eye on mean platelet volume of the adolescents. Psychosocial issues would also come attached with it, because the adolescent has very low self-esteem because of poor body image, obesity, hyperandrogenism because of hirsutism, could lead to depression and anxiety. Next. The pathophysiology of PCOS, although still not entirely clear, but mainly due to hormonal imbalance caused by both hyperandrogenism and hyperinsulinemia, both of which are augmenting each other. It sets up a very vicious cycle, which we have to break. Next. So insulin resistance leads to hyperinsulinemia, which is elevated levels of insulin in blood. Elevated levels of insulin cause decreased sex hormone binding globulin, which is produced by the liver, increased ovarian androgen production, and disordered release of LH and FSH from the pituitary. Hyperandrogenism in the blood, the levels equals male hormones. Oligoanovulation can be seen, or irregular ovulation is seen, and thus resulting we have a polycystic morphology. Although in adolescents it is said that do not get an ultrasound done for polycystic ovarian morphology before post 8 years postmenarche. Next. So AMH has a value because it is responsible for the growth of primordial, preantral, and small preantral and large preantral follicles, which are not FSH dependent. Once they become FSH dependent, then the role of AMH is over. Next. So the in adolescent and adult PCOS, serum AMH is significantly higher, although it should not be used as an alternative for detecting polycystic ovarian morphology or as a single test for diagnosis of PCOS. Significant overlap in levels as well as heterogeneity between assays and life stages and phenotypes of the population has been seen. So improved standardization of assays and established cutoff levels based on different ages and ethnicities are required to label a person as abnormal AMH. Next. So evaluation could be, we can see a cutaneous manifestation, that is terminal hair growth, acne, alopecia, acanthosis nigricans, skin tags. These are all present in the ratio of 10 to 20% of the patients. Next. Next. Click on the slide. Click on the, yeah. So obesity, that is increased obesity, particularly abdominal, which is associated with hyperandrogenemia and increased metabolic risk. We say a waist circumference. With the central obesity increasing, there will be increased waist circumference. Greater than 35 inches or 88 centimeters carries a higher risk of cardiovascular morbidity. Screening for increased adiposity has been done by BMI and measurement of waist circumference as evidenced by Endocrine Society. Next. Depression, I said, because of poor body image, screening for depression and anxiety by history, and if identified, referral for treatment is required. Next. Rescreening every 3 to 5 years. It has to be rescreened because it is a progressive disease. So we have to see, is it evolving or it is resolving? So more frequent rescreening would be required if there is worrying central adiposity, because it's a marker for metabolic syndrome and cardiovascular risk, substantial weight gain, and or symptoms of diabetes develop. Next. So the treatment, definitely we are looking at a magical treatment for PCOS. The lines of therapy would be, first would be lifestyle changes, that is dietary modification and exercise. This is followed either by oral contraceptive pills when there are control, we need control of symptoms for hyperandrogenism, or metformin in patients who have impaired glucose tolerance or have features of metabolic syndrome. Next. So lifestyle therapy is, first is weight loss, calorie restricted diet, beneficial for both reproductive and metabolic dysfunction. Why? Because obesity during adolescence is an important factor that conditions the evolution of ovarian function as well as metabolic disorders. Next. So weight loss of 2 to 5% results in decrease in testosterone levels by 21%. That is remarkable. And this resumes regular ovulation in about 50% of the women. Next. So exercise in overweight and obese patient, it improves weight loss and reduces cardiovascular morbidity and diabetes risk. We have to, the person has to avoid alcohol, smoking, and psychosocial stress. Next. Hormonal contraceptives are indicated as a first-line management for menstrual irregularities and hirsutism and acne. Next. Metabolic effects of COCs. Yes, they do have. But lower dose COCs with less ethinyl estradiol, there will be milder deterioration of glucose tolerance and worsening of lipid profile. It should not influence our choice of the drug we are going to use for an adolescent. Next. The concerns are basically hypertension in few, 10 mm rise of BP has been seen. Weight gain is not a complication with low dose COCs. And acne, in fact, OCP treatment is preferred because we have anti-androgenic pills with anti-androgenic progestational activity. Example is ciprofloxacin acetate and rosperinol. Next. Venous thromboembolism risk increases not with the COCs but with your BMI. If your BMI is around 25 to 30 kilogram per meter square, the risk is around 1.5. It increases to 4.34 when BMI reaches greater than 35. Risk is further increased in CPA or third generation progesterones, including rosperinol, if we are using it for a longer term. So metformin is to treat when there is impaired glucose tolerance or metabolic syndrome. Long-term resumption of ovulation, especially those with an inadequate response to lifestyle intervention, metformin can give us results. Commonly used as first-line monotherapy or in combination with OCPs or anti-androgens. Next. So combine metformin with oral contraceptives, it attenuates the adverse metabolic effects of oral contraceptives, improving body composition as compared with oral contraceptives alone. Duration, it has not yet been determined. Until the patient, maybe we can use until the patient is gynecologically mature, that is 5 years postmenarchal, or has lost a substantial amount of weight and has an improved menstrual pattern or improved metabolic profile, because we are looking at a better state. Now, next. Now we are looking at the use of inositols. These all drugs, these all chemical drugs which we were using, like metformin and oral contraceptives, they are drugs. But inositols are nutraceuticals, and they are similar to glucose in their structures. So they are important in insulin signaling. And as we know, hyperinsulinemia is the basic cause of PCOS presentation. So insulin receptor resides in the cell membrane, where its beta subunit is phosphorylated by insulin. Insulin receptor substrates are activated. P13 docks to the insulin receptor substrates, which then leads to phosphorylation of phosphatidyl inositol, eventuating in insulin action. Myinositol increases insulin sensitivity by making more phosphatidyl inositol available. Thus, the patient becomes more insulin sensitive, and the impaired glucose tolerance would decrease, and the metabolic morbidity would decrease. Next. In MI and DCI deficiency, it has been seen the plasma levels of inositols are lower and the urinary excretion of inositols is more. Next. So the role of myinositol is very, very essential for cell growth and survival. Central nervous system, myinositol is essential for development and function of peripheral nerves. In bones, it increases calcium in bones, increases the strength of bone structure. It is essential to bone formation, osteogenesis, and bone mineral density. Metabolism, we always know that it improves insulin sensitivity, thus decreasing HOMA-IR and decreases glycemia and hyperinsulinemia. It decreases total and low-density lipoproteins, cholesterol, increases HDL cholesterol, and decreases serum triglycerides. So it improves the metabolic syndrome. In reproduction, it restores normal ovulatory activity. It improves the oocyte and egg quality, increases fertilization rate, improves sperm motility and mitochondrial membrane potential in vitro. It also elevates the mood because of proposed selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor like role. It acts like SSRIs. Next. So dichiroinositols, they work in a different fashion. Myoinositol can be converted by epimerase activity in the body to dichiroinositol, and dichiroinositol works through GLUT uptake, and this leads to increase in glucose uptake by the cells and improves the insulin sensitivity. Next. So myinositol and dichiroinositol, they are the gatekeepers on insulin signaling and glucose metabolism. And thus, myinositol, it's necessary for transportation of glucose across the cell membrane. It regulates the glucose cellular uptake. Dichiroinositol stimulates pyruvate dehydrogenase, necessary for ATP production by regulating the Krebs cycle. All this effect takes place when MI and DCI are present in the physiological ratio of 40:1. So MI also controls FSH signaling in ovaries, critical factor for normal fertility because it is improving the egg quality, essential for growth and maturation of ovarian oocytes. Dichiroinositol, although works at the periphery, it regulates the insulin-mediated testosterone production in ovaries and stimulates insulin secretion in pancreatic B cells, and also works in the muscles, increasing the sensitivity of the insulin, thus increasing the glucose uptake. Next. So the meta-analysis, there's been a 9 RCTs involving 247 cases. They have shown significant decrease in fasting insulin levels, significant decrease in HOMA index, a reduction in testosterone concentration, significant increase in serum SHBG. It will decrease the androgen index. And the trial sequential analysis of insulin meta-analysis illustrates a firm evidence of myoinositol, which is beneficial effect of myoinositol in improving the metabolic profile of PCOS women, concomitantly reducing the hyperandrogenism. Next. So there is an international consensus also. This has been given by European Journal of Obs and Gynae. Expert consensus says that clinical data demonstrates efficacy of MIDCI in treatment of, because these evidences are strongest for the dose of 4 grams of myonicetol per day. So administration of myonicetol is safe and effective to prevent and correct metabolic disorders in teenagers. Combining myonicetols with OCPs and anti-androgens, effects are enhanced and negative impact of OCPs is improved. So thus they can be used simultaneously in adults and adolescents both. Next. So there are 4 pillars of PCOD management. We are looking at the dose of myonicetol, which is 4 gram per day, which is the optimal dose. The ratio of MIDCI is 40:1. And the formulation in tablets and capsule, there is lower absorption. So it is better to be taken in the powder form. The compliance goes along with the taste and acceptability by the patient. And if the taste is acceptable, the patient will definitely give us a better compatibility. Next. So thus, we have to keep calm and keep on fighting because it is a harbinger of poor health for our adolescents. And thus, we are looking for magical treatment which can be taken. These are nutraceuticals. They can be taken for a longer time and safely given to the adolescent for a longer period of time. And as and when required, we can add oral contraceptives and metformin accordingly. Thank you. Any questions, I would welcome. You can share screening, Shama. We can invite the questions, if any, from the delegates.
Any chat? On chat box.
On chat box, there are none.
On chat box, there are none, I think. Anybody from the audience who wants to put up a direct question?
They can unmute themselves and put up the question.
I think this one coming from Dr. Sunila Naidu.
Right. Yeah, Dr. Sunila, you can unmute yourself and put up your question.
Are you writing? Are you sending it as a message or you're calling? You unmute yourself, that will be easier.
I think host is Sarvesh.
Oh, host has to allow.
Yes.
So they can't unmute everybody.
Ma'am. Yeah, that's the reason, ma'am. I request is, I request the audience to please put in their questions in the chat box.
In the chat box, yes. That'll be easier. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Already the messages have started. So one of the messages is from Dr. Manju Agarwal. Great talk, Dr. Shama and Dr. Vanna. And another question, I think, Madam Ashi, please, can you just help in taking these questions? Ma'am, you are able to see. First question, mean platelet volume. Please elaborate.
See, mean platelet volume, it has been documented that it is a harbinger of, it tells us about the cardiovascular morbidity. So in PCOS patient, it has been seen that the mean platelet volume is on the higher side. So that once we are doing a complete blood count and we just look at the mean platelet volume, we should sit alert and see to it that adolescent takes good care of her health and thus reduces her cardiovascular morbidity and morbidity associated with metabolic syndrome. So that is the value of mean platelet volume.
Yeah. I request Madam Sahai to please take up the questions. Madam?
They have just gone from my screen. What?
How to reduce visceral fat in a lean...
How to reduce visceral fat? This is Dr. Pooja Devan.
Pamsa Chhabra. Poonam Devan, there was some risk with CPA. CPA, yeah.
About visceral fat.
How to reduce the visceral fat? Visceral fat is reduced by decreasing your input of fat and increasing your exercise. That is the only way you can reduce your visceral fat. And some risk with CPA, yeah, there was.
Cardiac.
With venous thromboembolism.
VTI.
Yeah. So we have to be very cautious and judicious. We have to keep on balancing our pros and cons and what we want, what is our focus for an adolescent who's just budding in a new life.
So follow-up should be there.
A regular follow-up and workup has to be there.
Regular checkup and follow-up should be there.
Cut-off platelet value, that's Dr. Manju Sharma is asking.
No cut-off. No, that's a hematologist domain. It's just a red flag. From our part, that increase mean platelet volume is a red flag as a marker for poor cardiovascular morbidity. Okay? So, for how long can we give? Although these can be given till the patient attains gynae maturity, post-menarchal, that is around 5 to 7 years. But we have to see that we have to keep on evaluating the patient from time to time and try to put her on a hormonal contraceptive pill, which is lesser, which has a lesser morbidity, as well as in adolescent. Initially, it was thought if we give a pill with lower ethinyl estradiol, every morbidity will go down. No, but that is the time when her reproductive organs are developing. We cannot put the adolescent on a lower ethinyl estradiol pill. That has to be a 30 microgram pill, but we can definitely choose the progestogenic agent. We can always keep on changing the profile of the progestogenic agent as and when required. If she has hirsutism, we give anti-androgenic, that is CPA or drosperinone, for over maybe 6 months, and then we can switch over to other one. And if the problem persists of hirsutism, we can add an anti-androgen. Okay, so that is the way we keep on evaluating and keep on going on.
I have given an adolescent given nearly 3 years.
3 to 5 years. 5 years post.
I have given 3 years, and then later it was fine.
Not only they are fine, but they have to be gynecologically mature also.
Yeah. So that and along with OC pill, we have started the MI also. MIND. Yeah.
MIDCI would improve.
It has a very good role.
Yeah.
Is it manacetol, plain manacetol, if you are giving without any hormones, will it work or it will not work?
It does improve. It depends on where we are standing with the vis-a-vis the profile of the patient. If it is just in initial phases, her testosterone levels are not too high, her LHFSH is mildly deranged, maybe she gives us a very good response. Mild insulin resistance. But as she goes on in increasing her HOMA-IR, the more the HOMA-IR, the lesser the response we'll get with plain minocetol. We'll have to add on the drug. Add on, yeah.
The pills. And contraceptive pills, according to her symptoms, if it is a more of a hirsutism, we have to go in for drosperinone.
Or CPA, yeah.
If it is more of a irregular cycle, we have to go on for estrogen-dependent plus progesterone.
Yeah, a safer one.
Yeah.
We can safer. With an orthosterone, yeah.
Yes, same question. How long minocetol is to be used?
Minocetol is a nutraceutical. Basically, the cost maybe would be the limitation. Otherwise, it can be used for a long time.
Cost is the limitation. Most of the time, people have around 60 to 70 rupees per day, only minocetol.
Yes.
Plus, if you are adding a oral contraceptive,
it does matter.
Normally, patient takes 3 to 6 months only, then they own only their living. They are not taking continuously.
Cost becomes a rate limiting factor. Mm. Otherwise, minocetol per se are good even in pregnancy. They reduce the incidence of gestational diabetes.
Gestational diabetes, yes.
9 times. Not only 9%, to the tune of 9 times.
History of PCOS in pregnant women. Previous, then we can start MI and DCI.
Plain MI. Yeah. We don't need DCI for them.
Yeah.
Plain MI.
Patients who have been on minocetol while with PCOS and they've got pregnant, and for them we can just be continuing with the minocetol.
We can continue very easily. We are giving her the benefit of improved insulin resistance.
Yes.
Because pregnancy per se is a diabetogenic state.
Diabetogenic.
And a person who is prone to insulin resistance would increase her chances of becoming diabetic and having an impaired glucose tolerance. and thus it will improve. It will keep on, maybe it delays the introduction of insulin, or maybe it decreases the dose of insulin required.
What's the role of myonestrol in lean and obese issues?
Lean and obese, we are using myonestrol for insulin resistance. And insulin resistance has been very nicely documented in both lean and obese patients. So in lean patients also, myonestrol would work because it is taking care of insulin resistance.
Has it been approved by DGI? That's what Dr. Manju is asking. In pregnancy.
It's not approved, I think. It's not approved, but we can give.
Nutraceuticals don't need approval, probably. I don't think so. They don't need approval.
But I think people have been using metformin, but I don't know, what about the myonestrol? How many people have used myonestrol?
I've used, and good results.
Okay.
There is a drug called GDM Save by Shield.
Yes.
Myonestrol, that, and added vitamin D.
That can be given in during gestation.
That you are starting in the second trimester.
Yeah, that is used to prevent gestational diabetes, rather. Yes.
So that you are starting in the second trimester on the people who show an inclination to go into a gestational diabetes. There has been an insulin resistance prior to their getting pregnant. Right. So we can start in the second trimester. I don't know about the first trimester.
We can. It's a nutraceutical. It's a glucose like. It has a structure which is similar to glucose. And it will definitely, if we are giving it in first trimester, it will, once it is improving the insulin resistance, it will take care of, decrease the level of abortions as well. Next. Any other questions?
More are coming. So I think we can conclude the session. This has been a very informative session. Dr. Manju has come with
another one.
It's everyone has any recommendation from
no recommendations as such. These are nutraceuticals. They have got no recommendations as such. It's all up to your personal basis that you want to add, because these are nutraceuticals. They do not give you any.
Any more questions anybody wants to ask? I think so. So this has been a very informative talk from both Dr. Sharma and Dr. Vandana, and such a detailed talk for a very complicated topic that PCO is never-ending discussion. Yeah. And for as I think everybody in their practice have been seeing PCOS in adolescents in and out, so we have to just keep treating, keep learning, and treating the patients accordingly. But I think the main stage is always reduction in weight and your lifestyle changes starting from there.
That's
the base. Even if whatever hormones you keep on giving, if the child is not motivated to lose the weight, it is not going to
work. Not going to work. Not at all.
It is not going to work at all.
Not at all. Not at all. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr.
Vandana. Thank you, Dr. Vanna.
Thanks.
Thank you, doctors, for the nice session. There are several compliments also on the chat box, complimenting both the presentations indeed in the content. Okay. Thanks so much, doctors.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Prasad. Okay. Bye.
Bye. Bye.